coin. Believe it or not, everything that we have talked about. So now we've done chapters 13, 14, 15. Now we're in chapter 16. Chapters 13, 14. Definitely information dealing with general census. All right? 15, information from the inside of the body. 16, special census. This is the point with our nervous system that we're at. Now, when we say special census, we're saying that for a reason. They are definitely going to be special. The biggest reason for that, their neurons are very specialized. Okay? Up to this point, we've had these neurons throughout the body that could be long and travel a long distance, okay? But now, look at what we're dealing with. The special senses are here in this area, okay? Can't really point to them, all right? But eyes, ears, nose, equilibrium, taste. They have a very close connection to the brain. They've got a very close connection to the central nervous system that they have to communicate with. So, the receptors are going to definitely be a specialized structure, letting us know that that neuron is extremely specialized. We're going to say that we have sense organs. What this is telling us is that we're going to see structures that work with other tissues, but this time they're responding to a special type of stimulus. One of the things that will take place, we're going to have the sensory information come to us in one form. The body is going to have to convert it into a form it can understand. We're going to have to convert that energy. For example, smell coming to us from the air, but we got to turn it into something chemical. Okay, so we're going to have to convert the energy. The being aware of a stimulus, and then the effect is going to be local because we don't have far to travel. We're going to have different types of information that's going to get recognized. The location now is very centralized. We've got it in one particular, pretty much one area, okay? Receptive field. That's going to be basically telling us what is the area that we're covering. We're going to find that for some of our special senses, what's the strength of that stimulus? And the body is going to have to either tamp down that stimulus or allow us to habituate to that stimulus. The duration, some of the stimuli is coming at us all the time for the special senses. Light, for example, it's a stimulus that's coming to us 24/7. Have you ever thought about that? Because you think about how, oh, well, if I go to sleep at night, okay, then I'm not being hit with light. But you are. It just depends on how much. There's only one time, there's only one situation where you have no light coming into your eyes at all. And that would be very deep underground in a cave. That's it. Or if I guess there are like some rooms that could be created, but I would still think if there's a doorway to it, there's a crack around the doorway. I don't know. I have to check that out. So if we try to think about receptive fields, well, all this time that we've been talking about our general sensations, think of your sensation of touch, for example. We've got to kind of get a concept of what the receptive field is. So, if we think about something such as a touch on our back, what difference do you see in these two pictures right here? The number of neurons. This one, one. With a huge area of dendrites. This one, bunches of neurons, smaller areas. This is letting you see that you can have a receptive field that's huge, but it's not going to be discriminate. Over here, this is a very small area of the receptive field, but it's lots of neurons, and it's going to be able to detect lots of types of stimulus. Now think about in the area where we're going to find our special senses. The special senses, we're limited to the receptive field, the area for it, okay? But are your special senses limited? For example, sight, okay? Probably the one I would hate to lose. Okay, and I can see that from the time of being your age to the time I am now, okay, the age I am now, I know that my sight's not as good. Very much so. It's one I hope I don't lose altogether.
I seen a video Facebook yesterday of this old guy, his wife and his children buying his glasses and shoes.
That let him see color for the first time.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Would he colorblind?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Colorblind's really a difficult subject. Because of the fact that people can, they see shades of gray, all right, that's pretty much it. And then there are some that only have certain colors that they don't see. They see other colors in place of it. So it's a difference in the type of color blindness that a person can have. Now, if we think about our special senses, sight, smell, taste, hearing, equilibrium. The receptors that are going to be picking up stimuli, we term them thermoreceptors, photoreceptors, nociceptors, chemoreceptors, mechanoreceptors. Temperature, light, pain, chemicals, something that's physical, pressure, touch, something to that effect.
Pain.
Nociceptors are the pain.
And then chemical, and then you said
physical.
Chemical, and then something physical. The origin of our receptors, it can be something external, internal, in our joints. Do you guys remember the proprioceptors? Because that's definitely the ones that kind of help us know our place in space. How does that fit into my special senses? My equilibrium. So, we basically say the two classes are my general senses and then my special senses, the ones that are located up here. Under these general senses, do you guys remember from part one all these different receptors that were embedded within the skin? Okay? Note these receptors. Some of them look kind of funny. Some of them remind me of mushrooms and stuff like that. Okay? But for the most part, they're pretty much looking a lot alike, right? Okay? Now, special senses are going to be different. But those neurons are going to be special. When we look at the general senses that we have, you guys remember how we would have a receptor? It would go to the spinal cord, go up to the thalamus, and be sent to the area of the brain that was needed to interpret it. Okay? Now, as we look at the special senses, they are going to have certain areas of the brain that process it. When we think about one of the general senses that I didn't talk about, it shows up in this chapter for some reason. But one of the general senses that we have is pain. There are people, however, who can have a hereditary defect where they don't feel pain. Now, it's just as bad to not feel pain as it is to feel pain. What's the benefit of feeling pain? Okay, it's basically, if you think about it, it is a way that we can protect ourselves. Because it's alerting us to there is something wrong. And if there's pain, then we're going to try to maybe reduce the use of that part of the body and let it heal.
So with that being said, why the brain doesn't feel pain?
The brain itself, are you thinking about like if we get damaged in the brain tissue or something?
Right.
The brain itself has no nociceptors. It has no receptors. That's why once they have, like if somebody has to have brain surgery, they're put to sleep while the skin and the bone are cut away, because that's going to be very painful, all right? But then they have to wake them up because, you know, they, hey, they're rooting around and they're with a stick. I mean, come on now. I mean, I want to be awake. I want to know what's happening, okay? So, you know, but yeah, put me to sleep while the top of my head's getting cut off and everything. But the brain itself has no pain itself. So now here's, what do we tend to do if we have pain? I don't know. Let's say that we had the pin prick on our finger, which, come on now, you got to take a Tylenol for that. Okay. But, you know, what about maybe hurting your knee, hurting your back? I don't know, something that's going to create some difficulty with pain. What do we tend to do?